Of the conference. Welcome, my name is Jiří Schneider, I'm director of Aspen Institute in Prague, and I have the honor to moderate the following panel, which will be on resilience. Just mentioned several times during the conference, and especially in the last panel on the European Global Strategy. We will start with Jiří Šedivý, our ambassador to NATO, who will talk about the concept of really resilience as it could be applied in Czech circumstances, in the national framework basically. Then we'll have Štefan, Füle, he doesn't need to be introduced, former commissioner in the European Commission, but also former ambassador to NATO, and the deputy minister of defense of the Czech Republic, who will tell a little bit about the international framework of resilience, how the national concept will fit into this. Then we have a guest, Matthew Rhodes from Garmisch. Thank you, Matthew, for being with us. I hope you will talk from a different perspective. You will look at our Czech debate, how it looks, how it's evolving. And last but not least, I'm glad we have Ivan Gabal, who is a member of the Czech Parliament, the lower house, who is the deputy chairman of the Defense Committee, and is one of the, I would say, experts who deals with security for decades in various functions. Before I pass the floor to Jiří, who will definitely mention this, since we are talking in English, we actually avoided the problem of how to translate resilience into Czech. And I hope Jiří will mention that. Well, if not, I hope I'm not taking his notes. It's difficult to explain by one word what does it mean. We usually use the term odolnost in Czech, but it's not exactly what it's the context of this in other languages. In some languages it has a physical context. It means the flexibility to the extent that after pressure something comes to the original shape. If pressed, this is resilience. But there is also a psychological contents of resilience. Resilience is used as a concept in psychology as well. Its ability to come to the former shape after stress. Then we are closer, probably, to the notion of resilience in security field. In sociology, I don't know whether, because Ivan Gabal is a sociologist, so I will try to use this interdisciplinary panel also to contemplate on the context of this notion. We are so happy that we can use it, but the question is how are we able to communicate the concept easily to the broader public, which is basically the substance of the concept in security, because without buying in of the general society into this concept, it doesn't work. So with this, I'm really grateful to Jiří that he actually kicked off this debate. He distributed a couple of months ago to some people a draft just hinting that this has to be elaborated, and so I'm glad he's here to kick off the debate. Jiří, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Jiří, and good afternoon to all the brave and resilient remnants of the audience of this conference. And indeed, it's not that the survival of the fittest, but survival of the most resilient is the now name of the game, at least in NATO, but also as we heard in the EU. Now, I'm very grateful to the organizers, Institute of International Relations, for invitation, and it's been now almost exactly 12 years since I left the Institute after leading, directing the Institute for almost 6 years. So it's always, it's also a very close to my heart. Now, I will speak briefly about the concept of resilience. Jiří said already quite a lot about that. Then I will mention actually how this is grasped currently in NATO, because quite surprisingly actually, this became the resilience and civil preparedness became one of the important, I wouldn't say key, but quite important items on the agenda of the last summit in Warsaw. And then I will come back to that question of how perhaps we may think about building national resilience of the state and society here in our country. Now, the concept of resilience, as Jiří already hinted, is taken over from the natural sciences, where it means the ability of a body or a system, a living system, to respond to external stimuli or shocks, and indeed to survive and to get back to the previous shape as quickly as possible. National resilience, I see as a, and actually Natalie mentioned that it's a dynamic process. It's a process, first of all. It's a never-ending process with open end. It's sort of a transformative process, which includes a continuous, I would say, capacity building that increases the ability of state and society to respond to emergencies that are threatening the fundamental values, fundamental functions, fundamental structures of state and society in terms of, first of all, absorbing the shock, and the shock doesn't or need not be necessarily external. It could be also internal shock, and indeed the absorption means above all maintaining continuing fundamental functions. In the corporate world, this is called business continuity. And we actually, and this is just a footnote, in our world, we should learn a lot from corporations in that respect. The second level of resilience, national resilience, state and society, is indeed the recovery, recovery as quickly as possible in terms of returning to the previous state, and last but not least, very important, third part of, and that's the dynamic and open-ended part, perennial, it's adaptation, means analyzing what happened and indeed improving the system and its resilience. Now, resilience became, as I said, quite, I would say, even fashionable now recently in NATO. At summit in Warsaw, the heads of state and government adopted a commitment to enhance resilience, national resilience, resilience of respective allies. that says, and it's a public document, you can find it on our website, of NATO website, that allies are committed to continue to enhance resilience against the full spectrum of threats, including hybrid threats from any direction. And resilience is an essential basis for credible deterrence and defense. The notion of hybrid threat and deterrence, and the context of deterrence and defense, are important because we speak about NATO, about the Atlantic Alliance, and the fundamental core function, which is defense. Now, another important point from the declaration. Being resilient, and I'm quoting, being resilient against these challenges requires allies to maintain and protect critical civilian capabilities alongside and in support of military capabilities. And here, actually, in our now discussion, it's really about protecting those civilian capacities and capabilities that support military capabilities. And just a few examples. Today, 90% of NATO supply and logistics are moved by private companies. 75% now of all host nation support preparations conducted in the eastern flank actually are provided by private companies. If we look at the area of cyber, I mean, we are almost completely dependent on private companies, and I can continue. So actually it's now in this context much more than it used to be, means military supporting civilian authorities in various disasters or crisis, catastrophic situation. It's vice versa, very important. Another important principle mentioned in the declaration and in several documents that are not accessible actually is that in the end it is above all national responsibility. It is about the allies, about the nations to build their resilience. And I should also mention one small contribution of the Czech Republic. About a year ago or 1.5 years ago, we came up with an initiative which we called mitigation or mitigating dependence on Soviet era equipment, because we realized, or I actually realized, having known the NATO defense planning process, that there is a lot of still outstanding legacy equipment. And in the situation when Russia is not exactly friendly partner, it could happen that actually we may have some problems with spare parts, with certification, with various things. So there is a dependency, and we provided for several ideas, then established a project, a tier two smart defense project, which actually mapped the dependency in key capabilities, and now we are working actually on mitigation, and this is mentioned in this commitment to enhance resilience as well. Now, we have NATO baseline requirements for national resilience, which means that actually allies are requested to test their resilience in seven areas: continuity of government, energy supplies, the ability to deal effectively with the uncontrolled movement of people, resilient food and water resources, ability to deal with mass casualties, resilient communication systems, and resilient transportation systems. By the way, this very much corresponds to the current audit of national security that's been undertaken by the Ministry of Interior. So that's for NATO, and just a short comment on the approach that we've just had from the EU side. It seems to me that actually we have signed with the EU a Warsaw Declaration about cooperation and resilience. Cooperating in building resilience is in the forefront of that. Seems to me, after what I have heard actually this afternoon, that in the EU the resilience building is rather more focused on building resilience of partners, while we in NATO, we are focused above all on building our own resilience. And to conclude, just with a few questions or challenges perhaps for discussion, and First of all, what is important when building resilience is a public awareness and ownership without causing or creating public fears or panic. Yeah? And I think that this is perhaps the most important also in current context when we see a lot of situations where actually various political forces are creating intentionally public fears in order to thrive. So resilience should be, and resilience building should be defined positively as a team building, national team building. It shouldn't be defined against concrete threats. It should be defined against identified vulnerabilities. And this is very important, not against threats, but the first step to increase resilience is to identify, assess own vulnerabilities. Another important important principle and perhaps challenge is the public-private cooperation. As I said, it's now blurred. It's blurred in various areas, not only those that I mentioned, and we need to have much more in terms of building mutual trust, be it in the area of logistics, supply, cyber, critical infrastructures, and so on. And perhaps perhaps third point or challenge. I mean, resilience is nothing new. If you look at nations such as Finland, Austria, Switzerland, Singapore, Canada, and few more can come to mind. I mean, these nations that are most of them are non-aligned, smaller, with some challenging environment. They have resilience building in their genes, especially Finland, for example. If you look at the Finnish system, it's really very impressive. Now, but mostly those systems are focused on material aspects of resilience that I mentioned, such as critical infrastructures and or indeed continuity of the government in terms of capacity of government to control situation. What I think is perhaps more important now is focus to the more ephemeral aspect of resilience, which is the societal resilience. And here I have in mind actually or dimension of resilience. I have in mind the overall cohesion of society, nation and society, trust between the state and society, or society towards the state. This means also that actually it's about a low level of pathological phenomena, such as corruption or systemic corruption, things like that. It's about building self-confidence society and nation, because self-confidence breeds tolerance. Self-confident societies in terms of understanding and believing in their own identity, in their own meaning, are much less prone to various populisms, to fears, panics, and etc. So here I would stop, and I'm looking forward to your comments, colleagues, and indeed to the debate. Thank you.
Thank you, Jiří. I think that was a good opening and good bridge to Štefan, who is going to speak about the European Union, I guess. Well, let me say, I mentioned the psychological dimension of resilience, and it is very much coherent with what you said on the societal level. There are three remedies or three ways how to boost your resilience, and it's self-confidence, self-esteem, and self-concept. And if this is missing in the society, then we are in trouble. I remember years, 10 years ago, I think before 9/11, it was absolutely clear. The tendency about policymakers, or even in media, was to play down security risks. I mean, that was the general tone. Everyone was trying to play down. You're overestimating risks. They were telling to the intelligence services, to army, you overestimate, you overblow the risk. Now we are in the opposite system. We have politicians who are actually giving a new steam to threats and risks. And this is a complete change of of the discourse. Anyway, let's move to a broader dimension than our Czech. Štefan.
Thanks, Jiří. And it's a pleasure to actually follow after Jiří's presentation. I don't know whether it has been underlined clearly. Jiří is an author of sort of the conceptual project and how the resilience should be tackled in the Czech Republic. Although it has not been yet tackled by the authorities, as we discussed it just before this panel, I hope very much that the idea he has put in this paper, and some of them he has shared with you, will find its way to put this concept of resilience into some kind of operational concept. Build skills to endure hardship. That's probably the most common definition. In the European Union, we have defined the resilience as the ability of individual community or country to cope, adapt, and also quickly recover from stress and shock caused by disaster, for example, violence, or also conflict. Now, the resilience is in a way our response to the threats of 21st century. During the Cold War, there was a clearly defined dividing line, and the issues of security defense were more black and white. Our security being provided by a deterrence defined by military capabilities. Today, we are quite logically talking more about resilience capabilities. Let's also not to forget that the opposite of the resilience or the opposite results of the resilience is a failed state with all these consequences and impact on the international security. So the resilience is a result of factors which deeply rely on culture and society. That's what Jiří has underlined. Therefore, there can only be a tailored-made strategies that individuals, communities, and states have to develop to influence the factors for resilience. And resilience cannot be seen as a task only for a community or a state. It implies the interaction of all the relevant stakeholders at local, regional, national, and also international level. Jiří quite rightly is focusing on the tailored-made approach within the Czech framework, and I'd like to add a couple of words about the NATO, EU, and OSCE there. On the European Union, the resilience, and quite right, Jiří, as you said, we place the resilience in a central role as an objective to our development and humanitarian assistance. But we have introduced something interesting, what could be used also in carrying out those national projects. We have introduced in 2015 so-called resilience marker in all the humanitarian projects. It defines the ways to reduce disaster risks and to strengthen the people's coping capacities so as to minimize the humanitarian needs. We have also introduced the resilience compendium, some kind of practical examples how to reduce the risks and strengthen the resilience activities. In the European Union, since that time, the concept has been developed. We're talking about it in the enlargement area, for example. If you think about it, the track record for the aspirant and candidate countries, not only to deliver on adopting the legislation, building the institution, but actually on those legislations and institutions working, is an important factor of strengthening the resilience of the Western Balkans. Are we talking about the resilience also vis-a-vis the partners? You're absolutely right, the Eastern Partnership, but even the global strategy for security presented in June refers to resilience. Now, Izzy talked about NATO. I will not elaborate on that. I will just only say that actually it's interesting that through the NATO, the European is getting more and more focus also on its member states. Because it was in Warsaw when there was this unprecedented agreement signed between both organizations, NATO and the European Union, specifying four concrete areas and improving the resilience: the civil military planning, cyber defense, information sharing, and also analysis and coordinated strategic communication to spot disinformation and to deal with that. It was only a week ago where actually in the framework of the Economic and Environmental Forum of the OSCE, we talked about the resilience also. A year ago, within the framework of this economic forum here in Prague, it's on the annual basis, we had even the panel which was called How to Achieve the Resilience in the OSCE Area. And at that time, what has been underlined is that this concept of resilience is closely linked to the concept of vulnerability. The more vulnerable the entity is, the more its resilience is likely to be reduced. We talk about the importance of the civil society alongside emergency authorities, non-governmental organizations, religious bodies, and so on. Just to conclude, it has been said quite clearly that there is a national responsibility, and actually the only working resilience plan is the one which is tailored-made. But it doesn't take away the importance of us working together within the organizations we belong. Jiří quite rightly is in his paper is underlining that our membership in the NATO and the EU is not enough to ensure the resilience per se. We need to work together, and we need, and this is the second important conclusion at the end of my contribution, it's important to work also with our partners, because the more we strengthen their resilience, the better we will be off to meet the challenges of the 21st century. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Štefan. Immediately pass the floor to Matthew.
Thank you, Jiří, and thank you to the organizers for the opportunity to join this distinguished panel. I'll start with the standard disclaimer that my remarks represent only my personal views. I was asked to join the panel in part to offer an external perspective to complement the ones you're getting from the Czech speakers, looking at the Czech national experience, the experiences of NATO and the European Union. In that spirit, I'll focus first of all on the experience of my own country, the United States, something which I hope is still relevant. We've heard earlier today that the United States is still a identified strategic partner of the Czech Republic, a core partner of the European Union, and of course an ally within NATO. And I think looking at, first of all, that experience, it's relevant, but I will also use that experience to revisit some of the recurrent questions or criticisms about the term resilience in security policy, which I think will be of broader interest. First, I think as several of the earlier speakers have already mentioned, this term resilience has a longer history in other fields such as that of psychology. And in fact, I sometimes still see it used in this kind of a context of this personal psychological resilience. For example, a couple of weeks ago, I was surprised when I logged into the website of the Pentagon office that processes my work hours and pay to see that it had declared September 7th as its Global Resilience Day. for all the employees who are using this website to consider their stress, their personal problems. So I hope the rest of you also celebrated appropriately on September 7th. But if we're looking at the kind of more serious applications to security policy, in the U.S. context, this really started 15 years ago this month with the 9/11 terrorist attacks on the World Trade Center in New York City and the Pentagon outside of Washington, D.C. Thinking about the theme of this symposium as being in large part about strategy, already the following year, the Bush administration included a reference to the importance of resilience against terrorism in its 2002 national security strategy. And this term was really even much more developed and more prominent towards the end of the Bush administration in the 2007 Homeland Security Strategy, focusing more on how internally we would react in the face of another serious terrorist threat. Now, a little bit later, when the Obama administration took office at the beginning of 2009, there is a very rapid expansion of the application of this term resilience to a number of additional areas. Perhaps not surprisingly, given the context of early 2009 as one of the most intense periods of the global financial crisis, the idea of building economic resilience was an early initiative of the Obama administration. This was reflected in new legislation regulating banks and financial firms, mandating certain kinds of minimum deposits that they have on their books relative to their loans, applying so-called stress tests to see how well they could withstand a financial crisis in the future, with the idea that you wanted to prevent the kind of domino effect that nearly brought down the global financial system in late 2008. A second major application by the Obama administration involved the environment, and especially efforts to respond to the threat of global warming. In early 2014, as part of the annual submission of a proposed budget to the U.S. Congress, the Obama administration included a $1 billion Global Climate Resilience Fund. This would have paid for, among other things, increased money for the federal government to respond to emergencies after hurricanes and other major storms that might be linked to global warming. It included hundreds of millions of dollars to help communities that are located on the seacoast deal with the problem of rising sea levels that were affecting drinking water, flooding land, and so forth, and a number of other areas. More recently, there's been some smaller initiatives along these lines, including just a few weeks ago an additional $40 million proposal to help Pacific Island possessions of the United States deal with climate resilience. And so these are two big examples. There's certainly been others. The energy field, including support for diversification of energy supplies in Europe, improvement of energy infrastructure in Europe, so-called gas pipeline interconnectors that would allow for reverse flows of gas in the case of a cutoff of supplies from Russia and so forth. The cyber field has already been referred to as, and this was another priority for the Obama administration. And to name just one more, recently the administration was looking at the questions of resilience internationally within the Arctic region. It came up with a fancy acronym called GLACIER, this kind of big block of ice that moves through the Arctic, in which the last letter R stood for resilience. So even in the Arctic, we have resilience. So given that kind of background of a proliferation of applications, it was probably no surprise that the United States enthusiastically supported some of the initiatives that Jiří Schneider talked about at Warsaw this summer. It supported this separate statement at the summit on enhancing allied resilience. It accompanied that statement with a number of other national statements. One was a signed commentary by President Obama in the Financial Times of London, which I guess is kind of the informal voice of pro-integrationist liberal Europe, in which the subtitle of the article was "We Need to Enhance Resilience." The White House also released a separate fact sheet on U.S. contributions to enhancing allied resilience at the same time of the summit to specify specifically what the United States was doing with NATO allies in this field. So you see this kind of growth and expansion, and including now within NATO with a focus on hybrid warfare and other kinds of threats. The question, though, of course, is that in a few months, the Obama administration will pack up its bags and leave. We still don't know exactly who will replace that administration, a President Clinton, a President Trump, or perhaps a President Johnson or Stein. But the question is, how will this next administration continue this kind of legacy or foundation in the field of resilience? And for me, it in part depends on how the U.S. nationally and its partners in Europe and elsewhere address these kind of underlying questions and criticisms that I referred to in my opening notes. And here, I guess, there are really three sets of criticisms or questions about the utility of this new term. The first set of arguments is that basically this is just a new buzzword without real significance. It's a trendy kind of fad that really doesn't deserve the attention it's getting. Sub-arguments here are that there's just really no substance behind it. It means everything and nothing. The other alternative is that, well, maybe it has some meaning to it, but it's really just a new label for things we've been doing for a long time. We had some references to, example, other countries like Finland that have been doing things. You know, in biblical terms, this is old wine in new bottles. For the U.S., we did a lot of things back in the 1950s about continuity of government and civil defense, planning for the scenario of a nuclear exchange with the Soviet Union. And to look at these current examples that I referred to, one area where I think the resilience term is really being stretched came from this White House fact sheet released during the Warsaw summit about what the U.S. was doing. And for me, even as a patriotic employee of the U.S. Department of Defense, it was hard to see value added from referring to the provision of anti-tank weapons to Poland and the Baltic states as, quote, focused resilience support rather than defense assistance or something more traditional. The second set of criticisms says that maybe there is really substance to the idea of resilience, but it's viewed in negative terms. Resilience is actually something that's bad for our security policy. Part of this debate, again, is something that's been referred to during the symposium about the debate over securitization of what really should just be seen as everyday civilian activities. If the provision of healthcare or maintenance of roads, education and everything is suddenly a security issue. This raises some risk, according to some analysts. It creates a kind of more controlling approach by the government over society. It may restrict and limit political debate about what are properly open civilian questions. The flip side in the resilience is bad approach is not that it's perhaps too powerful of a tool, but that it's perhaps too weak and too late. They see a focus on resilience as a kind of a substitute for policy approaches that would work to address these threats earlier, before they do damage, rather than trying to react to them afterwards. Again, to refer to the U.S. experience in the last decade, I think there was a reason that the Bush administration talked less about resilience in the early years. It was much more focused on prevention, or what it called preemption of the terrorist threat. The idea that you wait to be resilient in some ways was seen as giving up on the ability to stop those attacks. You get similar kinds of arguments from climate activists who say that if we talk about being resilient to climate change, to adapting or mitigating its effect, we're giving up on cutting the greenhouse gas emissions in the first place, which is in their view, much more important. This then gets to perhaps a third kind of concern with with this. And maybe I should backtrack. In theory, it's not an either-or proposition. It's not that you either do prevention or you do resilience. In theory, it would be very good to do both as part of a comprehensive package. But in practice, this might be hard because people have, you know, kind of limited time to focus on policy. You have limited financial resources. So this could mean that in practice and not in theory, there can be a kind of a zero-sum relationship between the two parts of policy. And this then gets to the third set of questions or concerns. And this is the idea that, yes, resilience is meaningful, and it could even be very good in principle, but it's very hard to achieve through policy in practice. Some of the challenges, I think, have been referred to by the other speakers. The resilience involves so many different things, so many different moving parts, that trying to bring them together through strategy in any kind of coherent, comprehensive way is intellectually very difficult. This becomes even more so if we need to bring together so many different actors in this process. If we need all the different levels of government, from the central capital to the provinces to the local communities, if we need private-public partnerships involving independent private industry, civil society organizations, and so forth. And then if beyond that, we also need cooperation at the international level among different organizational groups or frameworks of countries. Much of this symposium has focused on some of the challenges of cooperation, even at the regional level within the V4, and certainly as we've heard this afternoon through the EU, agreeing on a common strategy was very difficult. NATO has its own challenges, and now if we're talking about needing cooperation between NATO and the EU, even with their overlapping memberships, this has proven very difficult in the past. And so my conclusion, I guess, would be that I would come down maybe on the side of this last set of perspectives, that I think for the US and for other countries, resilience is very important and very valuable. It's much better than simply doing nothing and hoping you don't have an attack or you don't have a breakdown of your cyber network in the future. But I think that as we approach it, we need to be very cautious and very humble about what we'll be able to achieve and realistic about just how much effort we'll need to go in to making resilience this kind of successful unifying framework for strategy that it at least has the potential to be.
Thank you very much. I was hoping that you will raise some critical perspectives, and thank you for that. This is a really a dilemma, and it is I don't know whether a zero-sum game in terms of resources, but in terms of policies, it's not either or, but are we able to actually address the root causes of all these risks? Sometimes we think we are able, and we are not humble in that. And so we design a big policies to actually uproot these causes. Then we realize that, in fact, this is not that straightforward. And so we focus on resilience. And I think both has its merits and its currency, and it's needed. I think it's very important to not to be seen as an easy prey to the external threats if you have clearly demonstrate that you have a very low resilience. You are just calling for others to employ the weaknesses. And so that's something, that's probably the reason why we are now focusing on our own weaknesses. Ivan Gabal, how practical you see it in your work as as someone who is allocating resources or deciding how to allocate resources in security and legislating in the Czech Parliament. How practical is it?
Thank you, Jiří. I think that we are at the beginning in developing sort of concept of Brazilian for various dimension of Czech readiness or defense. And beginning means I've got just strong indicator that I became a very provincial Czech member of parliament because I made my notes in Czech. And and around the expression kondice, which means fitness. I don't know how much kondice fits into fitness, but I think that resilient debate, at least, may bring things in a positive direction, mainly for me as being sociologist, to base our policies more on knowledge, diagnosis, research, rather than ideology or game of fear. And if we continue in this direction here in Czech environment, I think we can bring certain improvement to the Czech both legislation and executive policies, because I think that the position of knowledge-based policies or policy is rather weak here in our environment. And I think that playing with fear as well as built on ideology is more easier, is more successful, right, and easily to voice. So, and when talking about the knowledge base, let's say, build-up of resilience, I see two parts of the coin. One part is obviously analysis or diagnosis of threats and deepening their knowledge, which means bringing threat into certain manageable risk factor to know it. And on the other side, to share this knowledge with the policymakers first and public second. For B, I think that we should talk about the resilience of society, which means in our case to think about strengthening cohesion of Czech society. And I think this is new because basically we built all the transition period on really very much personal individual responsibility, and we weakened cohesion on a level where people do prefer their individual solution to find securities, standard of living, solve their own problems, and we declined the, let's say, feeling for common interest of society and common interest of state on a level which really, I think, needs certain attention. So to build up cohesion and certain solidarity between citizens and state and state institution is a very complex task and a very proper one, I think, both for Czech politics and I would say approach to to the public opinion. Last but not least, we talk, and we have to talk about resilience in terms, or as was mentioned, hybrid threats, terrorism, and let's speak disinformation effort to weaken cohesion of Czech society and not only Czech society. So we talk about the abilities or resilience of social groups, communities to resist this sort of hybrid effort or fear in general. I think terrorism obviously plays with public fear, and when overlooking Czech environment and political debate during last 1.5 years, we were very first victim of Daesh effective communication, and Czech public and Czech politics really fall into games of fear, in spite that we didn't have a single migrant on our territory. So we have to work with the society as social group, individuals, and to face that a main target of these strategies is really decline cohesion and divide society. And it's true that when looking on recent interesting events in Europe, you can observe in sociological data that the level of division of Czech society and of other societies becomes really dangerous. Let me mention the data coming out from the British vote on Brexit. You see social inequalities playing such a huge role that it is really becoming, very hard for British politics to find out strategy acceptable for both parts of society. We saw a similar case with the regional German elections, where when reading recent German analysis, they say, okay, there is a vote of people who feel threatened by globalization as outcasts, and they vote with fear, not with knowledge and information. And when looking on a Czech data, when analyzing more deeply this part of Czech society threatened by migration, Islam, etc., you see more deeply social deprivation of people who feel lost as a losers of transition or social inequalities, and they are using different topics to display their frustration. And last was migration. So migration was used to display this sort of frustration and lack of communality or communality feeling with the general society. And as I said, migration, in spite we have no migrants here and no Muslim community, nothing. So when talking about resilience, we should consider, and last but not least, when you look on a recent presidential elections in Austria and the role of education, you see very similar picture. So basically, talking about resilience, we should talk about the ability of society to find certain cohesion and integration. And when speaking about the impact of this, let's say, Czech factor or Austrian factor on NATO or EU, we have to see that the slowest camel may define the speed of the whole caravan. So we should work not to be the slowest camel at least. And to apply certain concept, I would be happy to see for this, if we decide to go this direction, to see really some positioning or some coordinator, and finally larger cooperation between the government or institutions or parliament with academic research. Because in mainly in our case, contrary to traditional EU countries, not only sociological, but in general social research, it's really outcast from the point of view of influencing politics. So we have to redefine relation between knowledge-based politics and participation of our academics, universities, research capacities. Thank you.
I guess your last sentence was a nice song for our academicians in this room. So let's take it as it is. I'm not sure how your comparison or parallel with the caravan and camels would work in a public space. Some would say that we don't want camels and caravans in Europe. I think we want horses here, and I'm afraid that even this notion is already burdened. Anyway, we have had a broad range of presentations. I would like first, before opening the floor, to give floor to Jiří Schneider. There is one interesting element Matthew mentioned, that concept of resilience could be actually taken as a backdoor for securitization of some areas, where I felt just the opposite, that it could be a way how to foster security without securitization. So what's your view, Jiří, on this? Because this is a debate which is ongoing here for some years.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Matt, for very valid points. And indeed, I mean, it depends how you grasp it. And this is this, and that's why I was trying to emphasize that actually we should not securitize this, that we should, that planning for resilience enhancement should not be driven by threat, but by identification of vulnerabilities. Yeah, that's this point. It does not mean, actually, and we see it already, I mean, in our debates here, but also in Europe, that certain forces, populists and various extremes, actually, will hijack this issue in order, actually, to promote their agenda and so on. Now, you also said that, actually, is it anything new? Isn't it just an old wine in a new bottle? There are many, many things that are undergoing here in this country. I mean, in our country, we have one of the best, in NATO context, one of the best, most developed system of civil emergency. Also, thanks actually to our experience from floods in 1997. Also, thanks actually to the advice from NATO that we followed. Also, actually, thanks to our cooperation with Finland. We have done a lot of with Finland in terms of lessons learned when we've been building and improving our system. Means the concept of resilience, actually the value added of this concept, is a new look at the issue, sort of a new organization. It's a framework that should also emphasize linkages or interlinks, interdependencies between various areas that may not be at the first sight actually connected or interdependent. And I also think actually it could be good vehicle or instrument for raising awareness and for that perhaps too idealistic, but I mentioned positive team spirit building. Yeah. So and perhaps just a footnote concerning that paper that some of you saw, some of you haven't seen. Actually, I wrote it just for internal use, and because I became somehow interested in the area. And my intent is now after this conference to rewrite it, to finalize it, and to publish it, hopefully, if they accept it, the Institute of International Relations, and so that it will have some public life. And last point, we are currently, I mean, our delegation in NATO preparing a project, we call it Resilience Training Network, with Finland. And this is important because Finland will be not only a provider of a lot of lessons learned, best practices, but also our bridge to the EU. And the idea is to establish a knowledge base, network of experts for exchange of best practices, lessons learned, and also, and above all, actually to establish a course in that direction, most probably in Oberammergau NATO school. It's also opportunity actually to invite some other institutions such as Marshall Center, such as Institute of International Relations or the Prague Institute of Security Studies to participate. Thank you.
Thank you. Now I open the floor. I think we have something like 20, maximum 20 minutes, so try to be brief and to the point. Yes, Ben, and then Viet.
Good afternoon, Benjamin Tallis from the Institute of International Relations. Thank you all to all the panelists for addressing different aspects of what is a broad and widely used and indeed misused topic. Drawing together three points from different panelists, I think Matt Rhodes is absolutely right to point to the danger of over-securitization. And this has been a consistent theme in inputs that we've had to the Ministry over the last years, particularly looking at migration and the dangers of over-securitizing that, seeing it only as a security issue and not therefore being able to take advantage of the positive aspects of it. However, we shouldn't fall into the trap of thinking security as such, or indeed securitization, rather than over-securitization, is exclusively negative. It can have indeed motivational effects, inspiring effects, and can prompt us to address the kind of societal issues that Ivan Gabal was so right to point to. We are only as resilient as our least resilient part. And indeed, unless we have a more integrative, inclusive approach to our political economy, as well as to our social programs, we will not create resilient societies. We need to focus on integration, and integration is talked about mainly in relation to migrants. However, what about the integration of the excluded parts of our local populations? It was interesting that Professor Gatti mentioned yesterday Lyndon Johnson's Great Society. Perhaps what we need to think about in Europe at the moment is an integrate society. We need to use this challenge as we have as a spur to actually drawing in more people to face not only the threats that we've, the more diverse threat array that we see, but also to take again these opportunities, to integrate them to opportunity. However, this then raises the question of what kind of societies we want to live in, which picks up on Jiří Schneider's point about self-concept as well as self-confidence. If we have a self-concept that has been raised by Viktor Orban or by Miloš Zeman, we might find ourselves not wanting to make that resilient. We would want that to be able to change. This is then a question clearly of the politics behind these policies. These are not neutral floating signifiers. Making things resilient can have extremely negative effects if we were to become, for example, resilient to migrants, to use that example again. So I think we can see very useful connections between the different points raised by the speakers. So I thank you once again. And we'd be very interested to have the paper, Jiří. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Viet Beneš.
Hello, Viet Beneš, Institute of International Relations. When we are talking about resilience, we at first need to answer the question, resilience of what? And we need to answer that question on two levels. And I'm going back to the discussion from the previous panel where similar issues has been raised. At first, we have to distinguish between resilience of societies and the resilience of states. And this does not always have to be the same. It could look like a theoretical question, but at the end, it's a practical and political question. For example, a free press, a wide freedom of assembly and demonstration, a civil society, these are issues that strengthen the societal resilience, the resilience of societies to resist foreign propaganda, etc. But at the same time, these very issues are sometimes seen by nationalist regimes in Poland and Hungary, to be specific, as something which is a threat to the resilience of state. Having too much freedom of press could undermine the legitimacy of state. Too wide freedoms of speech is sometimes seen by the right-wing regimes as something that threatens the resilience of states. So there could be not just a theoretical but also practical clash between these two concepts. And on the second level, when we talk about the resilience of societies, you have quite rightly mentioned the analogy with a body, a society as a body. But what is the reference point? What is the body we are talking about? Is it a national body, a national society, or is it a European body, a European society? These are very different things. In theory, but also in practice, we could end up in a situation with perfectly resilient national bodies, national societies, which nevertheless are do not have a pan-European coherence and solidarity. We could end up with a fragmented Europe, reigned by Euroscepticism and nationalism of national societies, which would be perfectly resilient in itself. And it also relates to the, when we talk about the resilience of state institutions, we also have to take into account the resilience, whether we are talking about the resilience of nation states or the resilience of pan-European institutions, or maybe transatlantic institutions like NATO. We could end up in a situation where the nation states themselves are totally resilient. It means they have 100% legitimacy, etc. But the EU itself and NATO by extension could completely lose its legitimacy. So my argument as someone who is studying European Union is that if you're talking about resilience, we need to think about the resilience of European society and at the end of the day about Euroscepticism, about things like legitimacy of European institutions, mm-hmm. democratic deficit of the European Union and things like that. So I would like to warn against limiting the idea of resilience to national bodies and national societies, because you know we can end up in a situation with resilience, with big national security or military resources reaching the target of 2% per GDP, but in a situation where the European society and European institutions are so fragmented that we will lose the coherence or the resilience of Europe.
Yeah. Thank you. I think the argument was clear. I'd like to ask if you would like to react to these two interventions. And maybe I take the last comment and then we'll end up with the final comments because I think we are reaching the
just
final
a very
time.
Very small comment because I had the possibility.
Do you introduce yourself,
in
please?
In the morning, Václav Němec is my name.
Thank you.
And I would like to highly appreciate the perfect analysis of Mr. Gabal of this situation of nowadays, especially in academic research and so on, and about the nature and so on. I would say just simply that we corrupt some scientists, but we never can corrupt the nature. And they are two members of the parliament, and they are members of the same party, represented by Mr. Gabal, who perfectly are very arranging very progressive work in the research and orientation of the research, is Mr. Bielobrádek and Mr. Jurečka. But I have the feeling that just even other representatives, maybe even of the government and also of the opposition, just are making a very, just using maybe the ideologic connection of that party with the Christian roots of Europe, that they are putting or they are making some efforts to put put them maybe aside from the mainstream. So, and that just a small just comment to what has said Mr. Rhodes about if you are about your donation and so on. So these donations should be done to proper addresses, to people who can really work, who can make a progress in the science, and then just to disclose the laws of the nature. And so that would be evident a progress. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'll now give the floor to the members of the panel. Jiří, Matt, would you like to?
If I may, to the comment of Mr. Benes, and I mean, you are perfectly right. A concept of resilience of North Korean regime is completely different compared to what we are talking about here, and it's still resilience, yeah, in their or from their perspective or in their perception. But what is then important to prevent that this becomes divisive, exclusive, or aim against someone, other nations, is that it's based on values. And if we this is for me still the almost automatic assumption. If we look at all the fundamental documents of the European Union, of our nation, our the values, you know, that are listed in our basic documents. If we speak about state, we speak about liberal democracy. If we speak about, or if I speak about state, if I speak about society, then I have in mind open society with all the related values and assumptions. And if this and we see a frontal attack in Europe, but not only, against the values of liberal democracy, yeah, which and here, I mean, okay, we can see this approach from the societal dimension as also a possibility to raise awareness of those values, yeah, in society. So, but that's one point. And second point, back to the securitization and over-securitization and all that. And indeed, I mean, someone mentioned over-securitization of migration. NATO now, we've been exposed for now more than 1 year, perhaps already 2 years, time and again, by various politicians in this country, in Europe, you know, that are asking us, why are you not reacting against the migration? Why are you not, I don't know what, building fences or shooting them down? And I mean, this is almost absolute attempt to over securitize this issue, and we are reacting in a way which is I think quite obvious. I mean, NATO is not the prime responder. This is not a military problem. This problem has no military solution. It's upon the European Union with all its justice and home affairs instruments that are appropriate for that. And if we can do something as the alliance, it's what we are doing now in the Aegean area. and most probably will be doing in support of the EU operation Sophia in the Central Mediterranean, i.e. Providing information and intelligence to our EU partner. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt.
Also, quite briefly, again, I would second this idea that it's useful to distinguish between securitization per se and an over or perhaps mis-securitization as something that's more problematic. And on this question of needing to research in certain areas of vulnerabilities, such as climate change, I think that's very, very important as well. But perhaps also to draw back to my conclusion about how difficult even something like this could be. I mean, in the U.S. context of the Obama administration's proposals for climate resilience, the parts dealing with research have sometimes been the most politically controversial and difficult to get passed by our Congress, which sees, at least in certain portion of the Congress, sees climate change as a kind of hoax.
Thanks a lot. Three short remarks. Benjamin, I agree with your point of view and your concern. Second, what Viet has been offering, that we look sort of at the European level of improving our resilience, I'm not sure it would work, because in the European Union, we're talking about the shared responsibility between the institutions and member states. We're talking about the organizations where we're passing part of our sovereignty. So it's logically whatever you're focusing on the national dimension of resilience has, of course, the European consequences and vice versa. You cannot sort of build it from the roof. And there is one more dangerous. Those politicians, and not only politicians, who for whatever reasons don't like the resilience and where it's sort of leading, they will be in a much better position to kill the concept of strengthening the resilience of European society than killing the concept of national resilience. And that leads me to the third point, and that's, I think, the value added of Jiří's approach and his paper, and I'm also looking forward for this to be published. It's not that it offers a concept with a clearly defined enemy as it is vulnerable. Vulnerabilities driven. But because of that, it also offers something what we missing in this society for some time, and it is an extremely inclusive platform for addressing our security. Inclusive in the terms of the political forces, inclusive in terms of the interaction between the politicians and society.
Let me conclude with one or two practical examples. We currently we are trying to legislate regulation of private security companies because there is a lot of activities really on the edge of legal environment, and we would be happy to see some relicensing and some credibility among these companies and people. And there are two concepts clashing in this debate. One is represented by government. Basically, we need to separate completely the field of private security business from the functioning of state and state's security and defense institution, and keep them, because it's something like 40,000-50,000 people, keep them really under separate market and licensing regulation. And the other concept says, okay, we are in current situation with the threat of terrorism and whatever, and we should do maximum for potential involvement of these people and these companies into general protection of security in our country. And I think that the question, what is really contributing to the level of our defense resilience and resilience in terms of public is here has a practical consequences. And second example, it's opposite. We recognize really increasing interest of citizens to get some participate in some military volunteer service, and we do not have absorption capacity on the side of our army to bring in all these people and satisfy their readiness to volunteer on defense service. So these are two very real and actual examples where we really debate the approach to this. And I think that from this point of view, to have certain concept what is really contributing to the general resilience and what is not would be helpful. Thank you.
Thank you very much to everybody. I hope there will be a follow-up of this debate. I look forward to the article being published, and I would like to encourage everyone in this room to read it carefully and actively participate in a follow-up debate, because I think that's what we need. This is not a panacea. But I think this is a debate from a different angle, and we need this different angle of a security debate in this country, especially these days. Secondly, we shouldn't forget that this concept of self-esteem, self-concept, self-confidence is important. And it's not a bad thing if a leader, political leader, says, we'll manage. This is expected. If the political leaders say we should be afraid, then what kind of trust we can expect in the society? So I'm not saying that everything Angela Merkel did was good, and the context of where she said we'll manage has to be considered, but the same fact, that the very fact that somebody says, okay, we'll manage this, is very important for the health of the society and its relations to its institution. So I just want to underline that resilience starts with the leaders, and it very much depends on their attitude. And the second point I would like to provoke a little bit. There is another concept of resilience, and you were hinting at it. You said North Korea. But what if the whole enterprise of European integration was just an aberration, and it created a kind of artificial pressure on a concept of organic national state, which is showing a high resilience and is now coming back to its rebirth. This is a concept I can imagine some of the politicians which have been mentioned here would love to develop. So it depends how you frame the concept of resilience. And I would like to underline the question of assumptions of some values. We should probably be explicit about these assumptions. We shouldn't take them as implicit assumptions, because they are no longer implicit assumptions for everybody who is taking the concept of resilience. So with these words of encouragement, I would like to call upon Michal Kořan, who is the architect of this conferences, already 8th edition. Congratulations, Michael. I think the conference and its theme has shown a high level of resilience, and I would like to wish you all the best in the future. So the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and thank you, gentlemen, for a great panel. I would like to say only a few words. There is not well much of us left here, but I would like to thank you very much for being, as you said, resilient. Let me just say this. Natalie Tocci spoke about the fact that we live in time of monsters. Maybe you remember that. I would like to say that these monsters are of our own making, that they just didn't come from anywhere, from nowhere, that there is someone responsible for the fact that in 2003 we lived in the most secure and most prosperous Europe, and now we live in a contested world. There is someone who should be responsible for that, someone or something, and we shouldn't think that it's not our responsibility to think about those issues. What we could hear here, or what we could see throughout the 2 days of the discussions, we could see a lot of very bleak pictures. Maybe the word troubled and turbulent was one of the most used words here. And what troubles me is that it seems to me that we kind of take this situation as a new normal, that we somehow normalize the fear or anxiety or confusion or the fact that we are leaderless, that we have no vision. We keep talking that we need to do something, but in fact we actually accepted that. I don't know how to approach this question, but I think that one of the crucial things in times where we're unsure is to keep the dialogue open, not to blame, not to engage in a blame game, and just try to talk and debate in a civilized way. And I hope that this symposium, with your great contribution and with your great help, did manage to engage in a civilized and meaningful dialogue. And for that, I would very much thank to all the organizers, to Lucia and Linda from the conference service, who are now hiding somewhere, to our interns, without whom it would just not happen. I would like to thank to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs for allowing us to stay in this, in all of, basically we rented the entire ministry for free for 2 days, so that's pretty cool from them. I would like to thank to the Konrad Adenauer Stiftung, to the US Embassy. I would like also to thank to the program committee of the symposium for their inputs into our work. And last but not least, I would like to thank you for sharing your valuable time with us. And I hope to see you next year again. And most importantly, we still have some wine left around the corner. So let us refresh over there, and thank you again.